simple example of artificial network, they are very, let's say, simple example. The first one is a perceptron, which we should find a linear boundary. It's a very classic and simple example. So here you can see that you have several points. Some of them are in red, others are in black. And the, as you see, the soft, the sample some point randomly, and then each then trying to make the best approximation. But you see that if the approximation end, the some points still are still out of place, or the training process start again. Here I'm using a simple perception. There is no complication at all. Just a one and zero. I don't remember quite well the detail, but I think it is just one neuron, so it's very simple, not complicated. It's a very classic example. So you see that he was left the last one. Then the curve, let's see. Interesting to see that before it was missing just one, but the next train messed up everything, so had to start everything again. So that's one of the problems with artificial network. The challenge in which was, let's say, partially solved by a scientist, I think his name was Goldberg. He said about the plasticity stability dilemma. The challenge is how to learn new ideas without forget what I know. So here you saw that somehow the system forgot, because the system was missing just one to classify. Just one. By eyes you could see that. But the computer messed up at the beginning and started again. So remember that artificial network, they are based on optimization. So optimization is somehow they are blind. So here you apply this kind of steeper descent method and back propagation, so on. This kind of technique, they are based on like local approximation. It means that you can fall into a trap, you can jump to a point that is energy. It's a good point of energy, but it's not so good from the practical point of view. So you see that here it was achieved. So here the goal was achieved, but we still make the training, because there is one guy here out of the place. So you see, just one guy as it was before. So you can see that the process could have been finished before. If you, for example, had given a freedom to the software, let's say to the training system, let's say if you have one missing to be classified, you can stop the process. So it could have to finish before, but here you have just one to be classified, just one, that the white one is being classified as black, so it is just one missing. So here what I did here, I decided to put the training was finished, so it started to mess up again. I put another one guy, just one, so see that the process was finished. It was concluded with success. Then one guy was placed. See that here I have done a kind of, let's say, a paradox. If you see here, there is no way that this problem can be solved. So that's one of the big limitations that was found with this kind of one neuron. So one solution is to add more neuron. Then you have more complex lexical classification. This one is just a straight line, so cannot do a miracle. This one, it's a little bit, let's say, very, very simple, very, cannot do too much. So here you have a paradox, as you saw. If you try to make a curve here, you see that is, I cannot see, yeah, maybe you see it, but I cannot see that a straight line can separate this group. Any place you place this straight line, you are going to have a problem. If you place it here, would be the best. So here you saw that it was almost, but there is one guy here and one here. So this is a big huge problem. So that was the, so I decided to shift a little bit. So I see that I tried to give it a hand. So the end still have the problem. So let's see the guy here, but now it's solved. Now it was solved. Now this guy, just because it's bigger. So in the end, I had to shift one. So but in UK you cannot do that. In reality, the problem is there. You have to solve the problem, not play around with the problem. So here we shift to the second example, a three-layer perceptron, which is a classical called the universal approximator. It's said that it can approximate any function to give it the amount of hidden neuron. So here you have a very straightforward, simple, even stupid function. It's a cosine. So it's a sine or cosine, I'm not quite sure, but it's a wave-like function, sigmoidal function. So here what I'm doing, each time you see the simulation again, what I'm doing, I'm increasing the number of neurons in the hidden layer. So remember that the output layer, there is just one neuron, which is linear. That's a kind of rule for that case. The input layer has the amount of neuron equal the input, the amount of input that you give. So the amount of input here are the amount of samples that you want to give the network. It can be the amount that you want. Now I don't remember now the exact number. It's not so important at the moment. I kept them constant, so they did not change. So here you see that it starts with one neuron and increase, and the function starts to put more neuron on the hidden layer. So the only set of neuron that I change here is the one neuron in the hidden layer. See that now, I don't remember quite the number, I think it was 5 or 10 neuron. I think it was 5, between 5 and 10. So let's see now after a certain number of neuron, any movement was successful. But remember that you have this kind of problem if you try to work, that it's not just increase the amount of neuron in the hidden layer, that you can have what's called overtraining. So overtraining is not good, because the majority of the data that you have in your hand for artificial to work, they are full of noise. So mean that if you try to make this kind of huge amount of neuron, you can have two problems. One is that the landscape to be optimized will be much more complex than normal, which means that maybe you're not going to be able to solve that because it's very complicated. And the second, you can be like training noise. And noise, you do not want to train noise. You know that is not the case. So that's one of the problematic of if you have too little neuron, your model is unable to do its job. If you have, see that here, it starts with the number of neurons, you saw it before, it was giving you problem to optimize. That's a problem of optimization. The function was getting too much complicated. Shapes here that before was doing just fine. Now it starts to get, because that's a kind of local optimum. That's not very good. That destroy the landscape. The landscape is difficult. So you saw two example, and I hope that was just to show you a little bit about Fisher Talk. So here I kept going to play around with the simulation, change the range and so on. So it's not, I think you got the point. So in the next example, I'm going to see a class called self-organization map. It was really brought by Cohen. So here you have a set of points, and the map should self-organize. Just for curiosity, this theory was developed by Cohen, and at the time he was studying, he saw that in the brain, your neurons organize itself basically on a kind of one dimensional. Your brain is three dimensional, but the organization itself is one dimensional. So the self-organized of the brain is only layer. And these layers, they can be, they are in two dimension or three dimension the itself. So you see that the map was able to organize itself to find a shape to get the points. So these are a very classic example. Recently, Cohen published for free a book about his map. So you can find the internet. It's a very nice book, and especially because it's for free. Self-organized map has been applied a lot in several areas when you need self-organization, such as in gene expression, in any kind of let's say that you need some kind of to identify some kind of self-organization of the system. It's it's a system, it's a neuron that has no professor. The next one is hop feed network. Again, this neuron has no professor. So this one is another one that is was very interesting. And the case that you have a set of let's say of a pattern, and this pattern are somehow by using binary organization, this pattern are inserted inside the memory of the network, and the network must reconstruct this pattern. So here you see that here is the one that make you mess up with noise, and here are the pattern that the network should remember. So let's say the hope field, let's say the idea behind his network is very simple. For example, when you are seeing something by your window of your house, for example, it's raining, you are able to identify the image, even the water through the windows, because your brain has this kind of self-reconstructing property. It's a human ability. It's a kind of associative memory. So that's one of the second name it was called, associative memory. When you see a friend that you have not seen for years, even if your friend changed a bit, your friend gained some weight, you are still able to remember your friend. So that's a human ability to remember stuff, not by, let's say, exactly how it is, but by reconstructing what by taking an image and doing the best of that image. There's a psychological test in which they give you a kind of kind of bad image, and they ask you to tell what you see. That image is kind of fake, that people see in a different way. But this different way has to do what's inside your brain. That's why it's a psychological test. So they want to see what's inside your brain. That's more or less the same idea behind the hope field network. So far you saw that all the examples was possible to reconstruct. So the artificial network was successful in other cases so far. But remember, the experiment is very simple. You have after the pattern is reconstructed, we go from a starting point, we make a kind of mess, like random flipping in every square. So what's right you be black, in the end you get a random image, like a blur. When you go to the psychologist, and so that's what the reconstruction happened. It's a classic example that it's kind of blurry, like kind of fuzzy image. Different people see different things. It's a classical, let's say, experiment of the psychologist. This one, the last one, you see the system failed to recognize. It's almost a zero, but it's not a zero. So this can happen even in human. Sometimes you can fail to identify some kind of image. You can fail to identify a friend or object. And there is some calculation you can do that as a function of neuron, you have a limitation of the number of image that you can keep on the artificial network. And classically, I believe it's as well a human. Human has a limit of pattern that can keep in the brain. It's just based on the fact that the number of neurons are limited.
Hi.
Hi. On this video, we are going to discuss some simple example of artificial network. They are very, let's say, simple example. The first one is a perceptron, which